Hello everyone, I am Dr. Yogesh Pawde. I am an assistant professor in Department of Biochemistry, St. G.S. Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. In the introductory session, we had a brief overview of the entire lecture series on clinical enzymology. So, as per the agenda, the very first session of this complete lecture series will be on general enzymology. The isoenzymes will be covered and the enzyme profiles we are going to discuss in this session. So, coming to the specific learning objectives of this session. So, we have kept the specific learning objectives as, at the end of the session, students shall be able to describe the sources of enzymes in serum or plasma, describe mechanisms responsible for abnormal levels of enzymes in serum, describe isoenzymes and their properties, and students shall be able to enumerate enzyme profiles in various disorders. So, coming to the introduction, we will be covering the history in clinical enzymology, the basis of enzymology, and the clinical need of implementation of science of enzymology in clinical practice. Clinical enzymology is the application of the science of enzymes. It is the science of enzymes which we are going to apply to the diagnosis and treatment of the disease. So, enzymology would be the science, but clinical enzymology is the application of the science of enzyme to the diagnosis and treatment of disease. Pavlovsky and his co-workers, since 1956, this clinical enzymology is in practice. Okay, so in 1956, they laid down a stepping stone of clinical enzymology with a study on serum glutamate oxaloacetate transaminase, that is AST we call, right, and lactate dehydrogenase. They have studied these two enzymes on myocardial infarction patients, and they found there is a correlation with the disease pathology and the levels of SGOT and LDH. So, since then, the investigation and interpretation of changes in levels of serum enzymes, abnormal levels, increase or decrease levels, have become the basis of diagnosis, and it is now well established, the basis of diagnosis and prognosis of various diseases. Now, coming to the part of general enzymology, now we are going to discuss the sources of enzyme in serum or plasma, because we usually test serum or plasma only for the enzyme activities. When we discuss about serum levels or plasma levels of certain enzyme activities, okay, so there are two types of enzymes we can discuss. These are plasma derived enzymes and other one is the cell derived enzymes. Here the word derived means where that particular enzyme will have the maximum activity. So, it is not like that a particular enzyme will have activity only in cell or in plasma. Activity will be there in cell as well as in plasma. If it is having maximum in plasma, that is called as plasma derived enzymes. If it is maximum in cell, that is called as cell derived enzymes. Okay. Now, whenever we discuss about the enzyme activity, so what are the factors responsible for enzyme activity? We all know, right? There are 6-7 factors like temperature, pH, substrate concentration, concentration of enzyme, cofactors. There are influences by activators or inhibitors on the enzyme activity. So, first and foremost is the availability of the substrate in the optimum concentration. So, there is the Km value, right? So, if a particular substrate is available in plasma, the enzyme will definitely show its activity in plasma. If the substrate is not present in plasma, even though the enzyme is present in plasma, it will not show you the activity in plasma. Because we measure enzyme activity, we do not measure the quantity of the enzyme. दैट इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग. वी मेजर द एक्टिविटी ऑफ एंजाइम, वी मेजर इट्स कैपेसिटी ऑफ कन्वर्टिंग सब्सट्रेट टू प्रोडक्ट. वी डू नॉट क्वांटिटेट इन वॉट मिलीग्राम्स और माइक्रोग्राम्स इस पर्टिकुलर एंजाइम इज प्रेजेंट. एक्टिविटी, वी डिसाइड द एक्टिविटी लेवल्स विथ वॉट कैपेसिटी ऑफ कन्वर्जन ऑफ सब्सट्रेट टू फॉस्फेट दिस एंजाइम इज प्रेजेंट इन प्लाज्मा. इफ दैट एंजाइम इज प्रेजेंट इन सेल, इट फाइंड्स इट्स सब्सट्रेट इन सेल इन ऑप्टिमम कॉन्सेंट्रेशन, देन इट विल शो यू मैक्सिमम एक्टिविटी इन सेल, दैट इज सेल डिराइव्ड एंजाइम. आई विल गिव यू एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ प्लाज्मा डिराइव्ड एंजाइम्स. लाइक देर आर कोएगुलेशन एंजाइम्स, सो द एंजाइम्स रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर यू नो कन्वर्टिंग दोज इनएक्टिव कोएगुलेशन फैक्टर इन टू एक्टिव कोएगुलेशन फैक्टर. सो दोज एंजाइम्स हैज टू बी प्रेजेंट एंड शो इट्स मैक्सिमम एक्टिविटी इन प्लाज्मा. ओके, एंड इट इज नॉट लाइक दोज एंजाइम्स आर प्रोड्यूस्ड इन प्लाज्मा. नो, दे आर नॉट प्रोड्यूस्ड इन प्लाज्मा, दे विल बी प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय सेल ओनली. दे विल कम आउट एंड विल शो यू द एक्टिविटी इन प्लाज्मा, राइट, बाय कैरिंग आउट द कोएगुलेशन. Now coming to cell derived enzymes, we know lot of metabolic reactions are occurring in cell. Okay, almost all the metabolic reactions are occurring inside the cell. So because there is substrate inside the cell and all the metabolism goes, happens inside the cell. So the cell derived enzymes, like all metabolic enzymes of glycolysis, glycogenolysis, okay, then beta oxidation, then lipid synthesis, everything. So catabolic and anabolic reactions are going on inside the cell. So the metabolic enzymes are the cell derived enzymes. And in the category of cell derived enzymes, there are secretory enzymes as well. So these are secretory enzymes secreted by exocrine glands. Okay, mostly those are digestive enzymes and secreted into the stomach or intestine, wherein on the foodstuff they will act and it will digest the foodstuff, carbohydrates, lipids, etc. Now, wherever the cells are producing those exocrine secretions or the enzymes, okay, and they are coming into the extracellular fluid, the cavities like stomach or intestine, they will exert their activity because they will find their substrate there. But where are we measuring the enzyme activities? We are measuring in serum only. We are not measuring enzyme activity in stomach or intestine, remember. So compared to plasma and cell, these enzymes, okay, exocrine secretions will be maximally present in cell. And there are mechanisms because of which these exocrine secretions or enzymes are coming into this plasma to show you some extent of activity. Okay, now we will discuss about the mechanisms because of which the cell derived enzymes are present in plasma. Okay, you know there is continuous normal aging of cell. Okay, so maybe a newly born cell or a newly divided cell is there, so its cell will be strong enough to retain the secretions or the enzyme inside the cell. Okay, over a period of its lifespan, its cell membrane will disintegrate to some extent. Okay, or its integrity it will lose. Okay, so continuous normal aging of cell will cause increase in permeability of the cell membrane, because of which the cell derived enzymes will be coming into plasma. Then diffusion through undamaged cell membrane, though there is no damage of cell membrane, but still it will leak out because there are leaky channels. There are leaky channels and it is not firm like any, you know, plastic layer or something like that. Okay, but because of its leaky nature, its flexible nature, the undamaged cell membrane will also allow minimum cell derived enzyme quantity to come in plasma. Okay, so these are the reasons because of which cell derived enzymes are present in plasma. Now how do they leave it? So if cell derived enzymes are coming into the cell, it doesn't mean they are, you know, constantly increasing the level of enzyme in the plasma or serum. There are mechanisms because of which दीज एंजाइम्स आर लिविंग द प्लाज्मा और इट्स एक्टिविटी इज गेटिंग डिक्रीज इन द प्लाज्मा. ओके, वॉट आर दे? वी नो द एंजाइम्स आर प्रोटीन्स बिकॉज ऑफ द एक्टिव साइट. वंस दे लूज द एक्टिव साइट और देयर एक्टिव साइट इज डैमेज्ड, दे आर नो मोर एंजाइम एंड बी जस्ट अ प्रोटीन स्ट्रक्चर सर्कुलेटिंग इन द सीरम और प्लाज्मा. ओके, सो दैट इज इनएक्टिवेशन ऑफ द एक्टिव साइट. सो इफ फॉर एग्जाम्पल इट इज सीकेएमडी, इफ दैट एंजाइम्स एक्टिव साइट इज इनएक्टिवेटेड, इट विल बी जस्ट अ प्रोटीन and you will not find any activity of the enzyme because its active site is damaged. So there might be milligrams of CKMB present in plasma, but if its active site is not there or damaged or inactivated, you will not find any activity of CKMB. So inactivation is the mechanism because of which enzyme activities in plasma or serum will be decreased. Secondly, because enzyme is a protein with or without active site, it will enter general protein pool, and the proteases which are circulating in plasma or serum, even with a minimum quantity or minimum activity, the enzyme, circulating enzyme, will be, you know, disintegrated or digested because of proteases. So the catabolism in general protein pool is the another mechanism because of which the enzyme activities are decreasing. Mechanism is there, that is excretion in bile and urine. So enzymes like alkaline phosphatase, it gets excreted in bile. Serum amylase, serum lipase, to some extent, they get excreted in urine. Now coming to the mechanisms for abnormal levels, we have discussed about the mechanism for its normal reference range in serum. Now what are the mechanisms? Okay, any exaggeration or deviation from the normal is abnormal level, right? So increased production or decreased excretion, we can say that. So what are the reasons for increased levels in activity? Increased release. Okay, we know that there is constant diffusion through undamaged cell membrane or normal aging. So if the normal aging is accelerated because of the necrosis, if its cell membrane is damaged, you will find there will be increased level in the serum. Then increased permeability of the cell membrane, maybe because of the external stimuli or damage, the cell membrane is cell membrane has lost its integrity. It will lead to increased permeability, and because of the increased permeability, cell derived enzymes will be coming into serum. Increased production within the cell. Okay, if because of some cancerous pathogenesis or something like that, the particular enzyme production is increased, so more the production, more will be the release. The production is increased, its level in serum will increase. Why? Because there is a constant concentration gradient in the cell, a particular concentration in the cell, and because of that concentration gradient, a particular concentration in serum will be maintained. Suppose if it is 3:1, if the production inside the cell is increased to 100%, it is doubled, and you will find same proportion in serum level. So again, serum levels will be doubled. So it depends on production within the cell as well. Then increased tissue source of enzyme. Increased tissue source. Maybe cell is producing, a particular cell in a gland or in a tissue is producing at the given normal constant rate. But if that mass of the tissue is increased, like in case of benign prostatic hyperplasia, if the gland size is increased, that means tissue size is increased, number of cells are increased, so the production of that particular enzyme will increase, like acid phosphate synthesis will be more in case of benign prostatic hyperplasia because the tissue source of enzyme is increased. Then impaired disposition and excretion. If its excretion, inactivation or excretion through bile or urine is decreased, you will see that the levels of enzymes will increase. Coming to decreased levels of activity, it is the decreased formation. It may be a genetic disorder leading to enzyme deficiency, a particular enzyme deficiency, okay, or it may be acquired. Acquired means if a tissue producing that particular enzyme is removed. Say for example, in case of severe inflammation of salivary gland, sialadenitis and all, that salivary gland is removed. So the tissue which is producing amylase is removed, and you will find the level of amylase in serum is going to be decreased because this production is decreased. If we remove the prostate, the acid phosphatase level, prostatic acid phosphatase level will be decreasing because the tissue is removed. That is the acquired decreased formation. Then enzyme inhibition. We have seen that if the active site is inactivated, the enzyme will just be a protein. Okay, so the enzyme inhibition also leads to decreased levels. Okay, like in case of organophosphorus poisoning, the acetylcholine esterase is inhibited. Okay, and you will find its activity decreased in case of OVA poisoning, for example. Then lack of cofactors. We all know if the enzyme activity is depending on cofactor, suppose for example, most of the cofactors are vitamins. So in case of vitamin deficiencies, the particular enzyme activities are decreased. Okay, so if the cofactors are not there, enzyme is there, substrate is there, optimum pH is there, but the cofactor is not there. In case of that lack of cofactor scenario, you will find decreased level of that particular enzyme. Okay, so there are many examples for lack of cofactors leading to decreased levels of activity of a particular enzyme. That is the basic, these are the basic mechanisms because of which you see the decreased levels in enzyme activities. And now how this enzymology finds its application in clinical practice, making it a clinical enzymology a separate subject from the enzymology. Early detection of disease, or we may call it as screening of the disease, where even before the clinical manifestations of the disease have occurred, there is no sign to be elicited for a particular disease. Still, even before that, you can find out deflections in the normal level of any particular enzyme, and you may predict that, yeah, this particular damage is going to happen in the given organ or a particular system. Okay. That is the early detection of disease. Like for example, in case of hepatitis. In case of hepatitis, before you see any signs of jaundice, you can find increased levels of transaminase. Then diagnosis of disease. We have found out that there are increased transaminases. Okay, but when the levels are increasing, okay, levels are increasing, and there are other tests also which are confirming the diagnosis of hepatitis. For example, transaminase is increased, and there is increase in alkaline phosphatase, 5' nucleotidase, gamma GGT. Okay, that confirms your diagnosis. Okay, so investigations of other tests, investigation with other tests will also add value to the diagnosis and will confirm it. Okay, so that's the diagnosis of disease after screening. Prognosis of the disease. We may say in case of hepatitis, for example, if the transaminase levels are increasing, okay, we can say this will be the course of the disease. Till this particular period, the enzymes level will be increasing, the patient may aggravate the symptom or not, like that. Okay, suppose in case of cancer, we find a particular enzyme, a marker enzyme for that particular cancer is increasing, we may say that this much extent of damage has occurred, increasing the gravity of the disease. We may sometimes say the patient has 6 months of life, patient has 3 months of life. So that is the prognosis of the disease, and prognosis also includes whether the disease is curable or not, and in what time span the disease will be cured or it will increase its extent or decrease its extent, like that. That is the prognosis of the disease. And fourth most important point, that is the response to the treatment. If, for example, in a patient of hepatitis, we are taking example of hepatitis, so we will discuss that. If in a patient of hepatitis you are giving treatment, how will you see the response to the treatment? Because the clinical symptom will not go off immediately after you initiate the treatment. What has to be done? We have to serially monitor the transaminases or the other marker enzymes which we have investigated. If those marker enzymes are decreasing, enzyme activities are decreasing to their normal reference ranges, that means the patient is responding to the treatment. If treatment is initiated and after a given expected time frame, like 7 days or 8 days, the transaminase or the other marker enzyme levels are not decreasing, that means patient is not responding to the treatment. We have doctor, the clinician may have to reinvestigate or change the treatment. Okay, so that response to the treatment will be given by serial monitoring of the marker enzyme. Coming to the isoenzyme, yeah. What are they? We will just discuss the properties of the isoenzymes, and the individual isoenzyme will be discussed in their individual sessions. Okay. We'll discuss the definition and its properties in this session, which are general properties. So, what are they? Isoenzymes are multiple forms of an enzyme. So, this word forms is very important. There are isoenzymes and isoforms as well. So, these are multiple forms of enzyme. So, isoforms are not isoenzymes, but isoenzymes may be called as form of an enzyme. So, these are multiple forms of an enzyme. They catalyze the same chemical reaction, maybe at different rates, and I would say maybe in different tissues. Okay, same chemical reaction may be at different rates in different tissues, maybe in different tissues. Okay, you'll understand this. What is the need of different isoenzyme in different tissues when we'll touch those individual enzymes in detailed classes. Most important third point is encoded by distinct structural genes. Okay, this important point, there might be an MCQ on this also. This property of isoenzyme makes it a true isoenzyme, and it differentiates true isoenzyme from isoform. So, isoform may have encoded by the same structural gene, but to be called as true isoenzyme, those different forms has to be encoded by distinct structural genes. Okay, so we will discuss that in individual classes. Differ from each other structurally, electrophoretically and immunologically. See, these properties are very important, and you will find good number of MCQs based on this particular slide. Okay, so you have to be thorough with this definition. Differ from each other structurally, because they are encoded by different structural genes, so little bit structure will be different. In case of isoforms, you will find addition of carbohydrate moiety or glycosylation, like that. Some modification of the structure will be there, which will form it isoform. Though it is encoded by the same structural gene, in case of isoform I am talking about. Okay, but little structure difference will make it isoform. But to be called as isoenzyme, a distinct structural gene will encode it, and you will find a peculiar structural difference. Because there is structural difference, you can separate isoenzymes with the help of electrophoresis. You can separate isoforms as well. Okay, but दिस पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट यू ऑलवेज हैव टू रिमेंबर दे हैव टू बी एनकोडेड बाय डिस्टिंक्ट स्ट्रक्चरल जीन्स. आई एम अगेन एंड अगेन टचिंग अपॉन दिस पॉइंट. एज पर द हिस्ट्री वेन वेयर द आइसोएंजाइम्स आइडेंटिफाइड, ओके, दोज वेयर आइडेंटिफाइड एक्सीडेंटली विथ इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस ओनली. ओके, सो द एंजाइम शोड डिफरेंट, आई मीन एंजाइम शोड सेपरेशन ऑफ द आइसोएंजाइम्स एक्सीडेंटली ऑन इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस, एंड इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस ओनली डिसाइड्स, इट्स सेपरेशन ऑन इलेक्ट्रोफोरेसिस ओनली डिसाइड्स देयर नंबर्स. ओके, वील डिस्कस दैट. सपोज फॉर एग्जाम्पल एल डी एच, सो एल डी एच हैज फाइव आइसोएंजाइम्स, सो द फास्टेस्ट विल बी द एल डी एच वन, the slowest will be the LDH5. So those are numbered based on the electrophoretic mobility. So the electrophoresis have a major role in, I mean, their discovery and the studies, various studies, their numbering nomenclature related to isoenzyme will be based on electrophoresis. Immunologically, because the structure is different, the antigenic response by the tissue, or suppose for example I am getting any enzyme from pork inoculated on my skin, different isoenzymes, okay, so maybe CKMB from a pork and CKMM from a pork inoculating on my skin, so the antigenic response to that particular isoenzyme will be different because the structure is different. And different structure will exert different antigenic response, and the individual antibodies will be generated against that. They have different pH optima and KM values. Okay, why? Because they catalyze the same chemical reaction but at different rates. So different rates means different scenarios, different milieu in which the reaction is occurring. So their requirement of pH and their requirement of KM value, that is substrate concentration, will be different. Maybe vice versa we can discuss, that because the substrate was available in the given concentration in a particular cell and the pH availability has made cell or the genetic structure of cell to produce isoenzyme which will fit into this particular cell scenario and will exert the same chemical reaction. So rate will be different and its requirement, or we can say the availability of pH and KM values of the isoenzyme will be different. Okay, so we have isoenzymes like CPK, LDH and alkaline phosphatase. There are many. We'll discuss mainly isoenzymes of CK, creatinine phosphokinase, lactate dehydrogenase and alkaline phosphatase. Okay, coming to the various enzyme profiles which we are going to discuss in individual sessions. There will be a session on cardiac markers where we will discuss in detail about enzymatic cardiac markers, because there are many cardiac markers. I'll just enumerate here. CKMB, MB is the isoenzyme we just discussed. Aspartate transaminase, lactate dehydrogenase, myeloperoxidase, gamma GGT, okay, glycogen phosphorylase isoenzyme, BB isoenzyme, okay, non-enzymatic, cardiac troponins, troponin T and troponin I, high sensitive troponin T, brain natriuretic peptide or N-terminal pro-BNP, that is pro brain natriuretic peptide, myoglobin and ischemia modified albumin. Okay, so these are the non-enzymatic cardiac markers. So far as our syllabus is restricted to enzymatic cardiac markers, but I will be sharing a video or a session on non-enzymatic cardiac markers also, and we will try to cover as many cardiac markers we can, okay, but after we finish the lecture series on clinical enzymology. First we will discuss the basic requirement of the competencies and later on we will be sharing the videos on this non-enzymatic and advanced detailed information about these non-enzymatic cardiac markers. Then enzyme profiles in hepatobiliary diseases. We discussed transaminase, AST, ALT, alkaline phosphatase and gamma GT also. Nucleotide phosphatase, 5' nucleotidase, these enzymes will be discussed. Few of the enzymes we have discussed in liver function test as well. So depends, we will in detail we'll be discussing AST, ALT and ALP in this session, and the gamma GGT, nucleotide phosphatase and 5' nucleotidase we will refer session to the liver function test. Okay, coming to enzyme profiles in muscle diseases, creatine kinase, CKMM, MB for myocardium, MM for skeletal muscles, aldolase, glycogen phosphorylase isoenzyme MM. Okay, we'll discuss this. Then we'll discuss about serum amylase and serum lipase in a session on enzyme profiles in pancreatic diseases. Then we'll go to bone diseases where we'll discuss alkaline phosphatase, then tartarate resistant acid phosphatase, which is an isoenzyme of acid phosphatase. Then prostate diseases we will discuss and various enzymes related to that, prostate specific antigen and prostatic acid phosphatase will be discussed. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you have found this content useful, please like the video and share it as much as you can. Please subscribe to the channel for getting all the contents notified in your inbox, and please press the bell button so that you get the notifications in real time. Thanks for watching. Please keep motivating us. Thank you so much.